Friends, at this time, we are going to begin services for Dr. Robert D. Essak. I would ask if you have a cell phone or any other noise-making device, if you take a moment now, please, to turn that off or place that in the silent mode. Officiating our services today is Rabbi Evan Moffick from Macomb Solel Lakeside.
We'll begin with the musical piece. Wow, such a beautiful way to begin our service. Birth is a beginning, and death a destination. Birth is a beginning, and death a destination. and life is a journey. From childhood to maturity, and youth to age, from innocence to awareness, and ignorance to knowing, from foolishness to discretion, and then perhaps to wisdom, from weakness to strength, or strength to weakness, and often back again, from health to sickness, and back we pray to health again. From offense to forgiveness, from loneliness to love, from joy to gratitude, from pain to compassion, from fear to faith, from defeat to defeat to defeat, until looking backward or ahead, we see that victory lies not at some high place along the way, but in having made the journey, stage by stage, a sacred pilgrimage. Birth is a beginning, and death a destination, and life is a journey, a sacred pilgrimage to life everlasting. These words, which were penned by Rabbi Alvin Fine, really express the Jewish philosophy of life and of death. And they tell us that we come here in grief, in profound grief. But we also come here as much as we can with a measure of gratefulness. Grateful that God blessed the world with the life of Robert Essak. Our Jewish funeral service is fairly simple, consists of some readings, some psalms, some reflections, and concludes with the El Mole Rachamim prayer. We'll continue now with the words of the 23rd Psalm. If you know them, please feel free to join me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He guideth me in straight paths for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou hast anointed my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. At the rising of the sun and in its going down, we remember them. At the rustling of the leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember them. At the opening of the buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember them. At the beginning of the year and when it ends, we remember Robert Essak, for he is now a part of us as we remember him. When we are weary and in need of strength, we remember them. When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember them. When we have joy we crave to share, we remember them. When we have decisions that are difficult to make, we remember them. As long as we live, they too shall live. But they are now a part of us as we remember them. Now I'd like to invite up Rebecca and Sam, each of whom will share their memories.
Dear Dad, I know you wouldn't want me to be too sad, so I'll just get that part out of the way with a poem that mirrors my feelings of sorrow, because I can't imagine a world without you. But don't worry, then I'll tell you my wish for your beautiful and vibrant spirit to live on. This poem is called Funeral Blues by W.H. Auden. Stop all the clocks, cut off the telephone, prevent the dog from barking with a juicy bone. Silence the pianos and with muffled drum, bring out the coffin, let the mourners come. Let airplanes circle, moaning overhead, scribbling on the sky, the message, he is dead. Put cray bows round the white necks of the public doves. Let the traffic policemen wear black hat and gloves. He was my north, my south, my east and west, my working week and my Sunday rest. My noon, my midnight, my talk, my song. I thought that love would last forever, that I was wrong. The stars are not wanted now, put out every one. Pack up the moon and dismantle the sun. Pour away the ocean and sweep up the wood, for nothing now can ever come to any good. Now I can say all the wonderful things about you that will make me miss you so much and fills my heart with love. Growing up, now and then, Mom would say, "You're just like your father." I never really knew what it meant, but now I'm proud, honored, and grateful to be like someone with such a free spirit and lover of nature, to be like someone who was so kind, funny, and smart. Wherever you are, I hope things are as peaceful as when you're fishing at the lake house. I hope you're feeling the magic like when you're playing the piano. I hope you're feeling as inspired as you are when photographing nature. And I hope things are as funny as all of your silliness. And I hope you're feeling the sensation of biting into a piece of Fannie Mae chocolate candy, and most recently, a strawberry cream puff. No matter what, I know you're in heaven or feel heaven, because when you were fighting the fight of cancer and the first ocular melanoma procedure couldn't be completed, in the recovery room, you told me that you went somewhere really nice while you were under. And I think that was heaven, but it wasn't your time. And most recently, I felt comforted when you said, "I'll see you all in heaven." And I also have so many memories of you and all the fun that we had. And I can always think of you in all the ways you helped me or made me feel special. Like when you taught me how to fish, and when you played with us in the pool at the farm, throwing us and making pyramids. And when we made wood tables to put in the crawl space to put our things on in case it flooded. And when you put me on your shoulders at the concert at Ravinia so I could see the stage. And our trip to Florida to see Grandma Addie and Grandpa Herman. And while the visit was fun, the highlight was when our seats were in the smoking section, and since you had asthma, they bumped us up to first class. And also our bike riding adventures to Lake Michigan and Chicago. And what inspired me to talk about some of my memories of you is how you encouraged me to face fears. Because the other day when I was crying at the thought of not having you around, you said, "Be strong." And that reminds me of how when I was little, you showed me this steep hill with cement on part of it. And you said, "It's fun to go down it on your bike." I was afraid to, but you encouraged me. And when we went down the hill on the bicycle built for two, I had the best time, and I overcame my fear. The other memory about being strong and doing things, even if you're scared, is when I was afraid to go on Space Mountain at Disney World, and you encouraged me to try it. And when I did, I felt brave. So thank you, Dad, for all the wonderful memories and helping me and reminding me to be strong. Lastly, I just want to say that you fought the cancer with courage and never let it stop your loving spirit from exploring all the beauty. I expressed this to Uncle Larry when he passed, and I want to share my hopes for you. I hope that wherever you are, the air smells like a beautiful flower and that your breaths are of a warm summer breeze. I hope the sounds are of pretty birds singing, and I hope your feelings are light as a white fluffy cloud. I hope your senses are as bright as a big golden sun. I hope your sight is as colorful as a rainbow in the sky. And I hope you're as free as the eagle soaring above. Wherever you are, I hope there's endless love all around you. Wherever you are, may you have a fishing rod, a camera, and a piano, and an electric bike would be good too. I love you and I'll miss you always.
already one here if I need it. I think most of you know that my dad was struggling with health issues for feels like 10 years, starting with a cyst on his pancreas, and then he had the neuroendocrine cancer, the ocular cancer, heart issues. But he always was studying and making sure that he was making the right medical decisions for himself. And he continued to have procedures and do things as he saw fit, and continued to live his life beautifully for all that time. And then just really the second week of July, he had a stroke, which many of you may know. And he was up north fishing with his grandkids and having a good time. And he needed to come back to Chicago. And we got him back to Chicago into his home, and he was so comfortable and peaceful there. And he knew that it was time to stop having all these procedures. So he really lived life to the fullest up until that point. And so really just a few weeks ago, he was at home in bed, and I was lying in bed with him. And I asked him, "What do you want people to remember about you?" And he responded immediately that I was a hard worker. And then he paused and he said, "I always wanted to be successful, but I did the best I could." And he was insinuating that he did not achieve enough financial success. I know this about him because he told that to me before. And in my head, I chuckled. Isn't it funny that he thinks people should remember his hard work when his life was about so much more than his work or his career? Don't misunderstand me. I believe my dad was an outstanding dentist, but he never focused all his energy on his career. He just wasn't one of those dads that was always working. As a kid, he came to all my soccer matches and swim meets, took us for long family bike rides on summer evenings after dinner. We explored new places and discovered unique and beautiful things without traveling long distances. He was always present, and his interests were vast. He was a pretty handy person and taught me how to fix things. I often had to hold a flashlight or a tool while he soldered something, cleaned the sump pump in our crawl space, or built these makeshift frames of wood and plastic to insulate our windows for the winter. It felt like I was standing there for hours doing nothing, but this is how I learned from him. We painted the kitchen cabinets and did yard work together, and I learned about basic tools. Nothing crazy, but we did it together, and it was hard work. We took family drives out to the Indiana Dunes or a small lake in Indiana to fish and hang out on the beach, and there was always ice cream involved, even though he was a dentist. I remember one time he drank a little mini pitcher of hot fudge at Mitchell's Ice Cream in Homewood. And the next day he suffered from a terrible migraine. And from this, I learned a lesson as well, that it's okay to be excessive once in a while, to enjoy those little pleasures in life. He had numerous hobbies that were a priority in his life. At times, I think he worked just as hard on those hobbies as he did on his career. He hunted for rocks and polished them, a process that takes weeks to do it right. Later in life, he developed his own technique for making jewelry with polished rocks. And they were never gems, always one-of-a-kind stones and individually selected by my dad, every stone. I think for Dad, the stones represented nature and something eternal that would last forever. He hopes that those of you who have them will remember him whenever you wear them. He played classical music and practiced piano into the late hours of the night, playing the same measure over and over so that he could perfect a piece. In fact, it was the piece that my aunt just played that I remember, and my sisters remember him playing at night over and over. He couldn't get to the next measure, to the next part of the piece sometimes, and he just practiced and practiced, and my aunt completed it for him, and I hope that his kids and grandkids will continue to complete things in his life. Honestly, it was hard to listen to this as a young kid when he would play over and over the same measures. And I didn't appreciate it at the time. But I do appreciate Dad so much now for what this taught me. I learned a little bit about classical music, which I've passed on to my children with the help of my wife. But I think more about that old cliche, practice makes perfect, right? It's just another example of hard work. His love of music has obviously impacted me and my children, both of who played for you today. Dad took me on fishing expeditions that involved long drives to Canada. We would get up early and travel for hours to small, remote lakes in Indiana, and then we would be waiting and waiting for the fish that we would never catch, while my line would get tangled up because I would be daydreaming and he'd have to teach me how to fix it. On occasion, we did catch some fish and he'd show me how to fillet them with his electric knife, a technique I've never seen anyone else use. Fortunately, I've never had to clean it myself because cleaning fish was a labor of love for my dad. He never complained about it. He wanted to share the reward of catching fish and indulging in the delicacy of a freshly caught fish because the taste is better than anything from a restaurant or a store. He would ask us to go on photo expeditions with him to capture a unique nature photo. Our role always involved carrying the camera case or a plexiglass windshield that he would attempt to place around the plant wherein he found an insect so he could capture the perfect photo. And this activity, like most of his hobbies, couldn't be done fast. He was meticulous, a perfectionist. It was slow and boring for a kid. You had to be patient. But for Dad, the reward was worth the hard work that goes into doing something the way he thought was perfect and the right way to do it. And then there were the trips to the playground or a beach to go treasure hunting with his metal detector. Anywhere that someone might have dropped a treasure. Usually it was just a few pennies or a quarter if we got lucky. Maybe we'd find a piece of jewelry, typically misplaced or lost by my mother, but it was always the hunt that he loved. Do you see a theme here? It's kind of like fishing or collecting rocks. You never know when you'll get lucky and find a hidden treasure. So you shouldn't be surprised that he also would like to buy lottery tickets or to find a better deal on an off-brand that no one had ever heard of. When I wanted a Sony Walkman as a kid, there was no way he was going to buy that expensive brand for me. He researched and found some off-brand with better quality sound for half the price. He always loved a good deal and taught me to look at the details and find the best option, even if it wasn't what everyone else was buying. Many times he called me in the middle of the day while I was at work and asked if I could use some special tool he found at the hardware store at Costco. He'd say, "I got it. I got one and it's on sale. I think you'll love it." Recently he called me and said, "I found some paintings of a sailboat in an art store and it's only $15. Would you like it?" I'd always say sure, even if I didn't want it, because I knew he'd get pleasure out of giving me this special gift. Which leads me to my final comment about my dad's impact on all of us. And that is his gift for unconditional love. Some people aren't so lucky in life and never get to experience unconditional love the way we did. His love for my mother, his children, and his grandchildren was and is never ending. He found so much joy in knowing us and our accomplishments, no matter how small or big they were. This is an amazing gift that we all received from him. He did it effortlessly. Living life to the fullest with more hobbies than anyone else I know wasn't hard work for my dad. It motivated him, and he was successful at all of them. It was what he enjoyed doing. And yes, Dad, we will remember that you are a hard worker. Your kids and grandkids will remember that about you. And hopefully we will all work as hard as you did to lead a life that is worth living. to bring us joy and help others the way you helped us. A life that leaves behind the kind of gifts you gave us. A love of nature and active living. A love for great food, especially hot fudge. A love for being with people and friends, even when you might feel a little uncomfortable. A love for beautiful photography and classical music. A love for not taking life too seriously and finding your own unique, silly humor. For all this love you gave us, we thank you, Dad. You are a unique and special person in our lives, and we will never forget you. We will tell long, never-ending stories about you and remember you in our hearts forever. Your life was too short, but our love for you is long. Thank you for loving us the way you did. We felt your love and will miss you terribly.
There's this beautiful story told in Jewish tradition, and it's a group of rabbis, and they're debating what the most wonderful qualities, parts of a human being are. And one rabbi says, a good eye, which means, you know, you can see into the future. They say, yeah, that's a good answer. Another rabbi says, a good neighbor. Someone who has friends, connections, gets along with people, so that's a good answer too. Another rabbi says, a good community. You know, you're surrounded by people, values you care about, so that's a good answer. And then the greatest rabbi of them all, Rabbi Akiba, says, a good heart. Because a good heart encompasses everything that is most important. And as I think we just heard shared so beautifully via words and via beautiful music, is that Robert Essak had a wonderful heart. It was a heart he shared with his family, his patients, with his friends. And it was a heart that, as I learned from members of the family, he understood as a Jewish heart. He had a sense of Judaism and being a good Jew at the end of his life that is just profoundly powerful. Because in Judaism, the heart is the source of who we are. You know, the mind is important, but the mind ultimately rests in the heart. And in Jewish tradition, the way we honor a loved one, the way we remember them, are just words that are so appropriate at this moment. Zichrono livracha. May his memory be a blessing. And these words convey the purpose of a well-lived life. That those who know you, those who come after you, those who remember you, look to your life as a blessing, a benediction, and an inspiration. Being a blessing means that you have touched the lives of those you knew and that you have helped them do the same for others. And fortunately, with Dr. Essak, we have many physical reminders as well. Jewelry, sound of music, the experiences, the memories, all of that shapes how we remember a loved one as a blessing. And while this is a difficult time, we may be able to take comfort in this beautiful Jewish story, Midrash. And it's about two ships, and they're each near land. One of the ships is going into the harbor, and the other is going out from it. Everyone is cheering the outgoing ship, as you see in movies, giving it a hearty send-off. But the incoming ship is scarcely noticed. And a wise man standing nearby chastised the people's reactions. Rejoice not, he said, over the ship that is setting out to sea. If you know not what destiny awaits it, what storms it may encounter, what dangers lurk before it. Rejoice rather over the ship that has reached port safely and brought back all its passengers in peace. It is the way of the world that when a human being is born, everyone rejoices. But when a loved one dies, we all feel sorrow. According to this story, we can also struggle to see it the opposite way. Nobody knows what troubles await the developing child on its journey through life, but when a person has lived well and lived a full life, all can take comfort in the knowledge that he has completed his journey successfully. Robert Essak, as we all know, made such a successful journey through life. It was a journey touched by a wonderful relationship and marriage, by children and grandchildren, patients and friends, and creativity. And we honor that when we say Zichrono Livracha. May the memory of Robert Essak endure among us as an everlasting blessing. God, you give us loved ones and you make them the strength of our life and the light of our eyes. They depart and leave us bereft on a lonely way, but you are the living fountain from which our healing flows. To you, the stricken look for comfort and the sorrow laden for consolation. God, we see life as through windows that open on eternity. We see that love endures and the soul endures as you, O God, endure forever. We see that the years are more than grass that withers, more than flowers that fade. They weave a timeless pattern in a world that is a dwelling place of your love and your presence. I'd ask you now, if you're comfortably able, to please rise as we say our final prayer in the chapel this morning. El Malei Rachamim, Shochen Barmomim, Hamsei Menucha Nechona Tachad Shechina, Im Kiddushim V'Tachorim K'Zohar HaKiyam Asirim, Et Nishmat Robert Essak, Shohalach LeOlamo, Baha Rachamim Yastirehu B'Seter K'Nafav LeOlamim, Vayitzur b'tur chayim et nishmato, Adonai hu nachalato v'yanuach v'shalom amishkavo v'nomar amen. Compassionate God, eternal spirit of the universe, grant perfect rest in your sheltering presence to our beloved husband, father, grandfather, brother, loved one, friend, Dr. Robert Essak, who has entered eternity. O God of mercy, let him find refuge in the shadow of your wings, and may his soul be bound up in the bond of everlasting life. For you, the eternal God, are his inheritance. May he rest in peace, and let us all say, Amen. You may be seated. I have a few announcements before we proceed.
Friends, this concludes this portion of the service. The interment will take place at Zion Gardens in Chicago. Upon return from the cemetery today, the family will be together at the Cohen residence. That's 2814 Knollwood Lane in Glenview. And again, that's today following the interment until 8:30 p.m. That information is available inside the folders that you received today as you arrived, and it's also available on our website as well. If you did not receive a folder, they will be made available as you depart. For those of you who will be going with us in the procession, we ask that you please keep a few safety measures in mind. Please make sure to have a sticker placed on the passenger side of your front windshield, which will be provided as you depart. Please make sure that your bright headlights and hazard lights are on at all times during the procession, and follow the car in front of you as closely as safety permits, especially as we make our way through intersections, so that we can avoid any gaps in the procession and keep everyone together. The grandchildren will be acting as pallbearers today, as well as additional family members, David Cohen, Jennifer Essak, and Martin Zeideman. We'll ask everyone to please rise at this time, and we'll ask those family members who are assisting to come forward as we escort the family, Dr. Essak, and the clergy from the chapel.